So tonight, I'm very happy to introduce Chris Roos, a recent graduate out of the University of Arizona School of Anthropology. And he's moved on. He's an associate professor at Southern Methodist University in archaeology, and he's doing some amazing research on the interaction of trees, fire, climate, and culture. So Chris, I'll just let you take it away.
Great, thank you. I'd like to thank Doug and Bill, Archaeology Southwest, the membership, everybody who came tonight and who support these sorts of great things. It's a pleasure to be here. I like to say that all the great things in my life have happened in Tucson. So I'd like to come back and add more great things to my life list, like talking to you tonight. I have many collaborators and mentors and friends here. And in many respects, the story that I want to tell tonight is about my relationship to the U of A and dalliances beyond and what brought me back. Because what brought me back to the U of A as a graduate student many years ago was a desire to understand the story of people and fire in forests here. And that's spun on to other related work. For me, going back more than a decade, this was really about finding a way to learn from the past to help tackle contemporary issues. So the theme of this year, the so what of archaeology, of what's the big deal of knowing something about the past, for me is one that even transcends archaeology itself. This obviously is situated in an even larger political arena in which basic scientific research is under scrutiny in some cases for political motivations. I'd like to use this talk and this discussion as a way to provide some evidence both for support of just basic research. Not applied research, but basic research. I couldn't do the work that I do without the many decades of basic science that's been done both inside archaeology and outside of it. But also for this type of integrated applied work that we can do when we look to the past, when we look to the human experience writ broadly in space and time as it relates to very contemporary issues about our present and our future. And so a lot of the work that I do is looking backwards while thinking forwards, trying to learn from the successes and failures, both, of past societies, tackling analogous environmental problems to those that we face today. There's no doubt that we face some pretty serious environmental challenges, but also have some opportunities and want to learn from previous experiences with those. There's also a financial context to this, and I've got some notes to make sure that I remember the numbers, because these are in some cases, shockingly big numbers. To give you some idea, right, the average National Science Foundation archaeology project, right, the average annual budget might be roughly $50,000 a year, right? It's not particularly much. It's a very middle-class science. The average amount of money that is spent on fire suppression over the last decade and a half, right, is about $1.5 billion a year, right? These are definitely 1%-er issues. Right, just this last year, 2015, we spent more than $2 billion just trying to fight fires. This doesn't include the cost to lost homes or lost work or damaged resources or infrastructure. This is just fire suppression. So if there's anything that we can learn about past human experiences with fire that can help us do things better, there's a lot of financial wiggle room for doing things better, I'd say. And a middle class budget is a pretty worthwhile expenditure, in my humble opinion. Now, a local and relevant experience with fire, just to kind of have a touchstone here, might be the Aspen fire in terms of big consequential fires. Anybody here have property or important parts of their experience kind of impacted by the Aspen fire in 2003? You lose property? No? The pie place? I mean, the pie place is one of the few places that survived, right? Although you could think that maybe there's a kind of a decadal lag, and I guess it's been replaced by something, is that right? It's been a while since I've been up on Mount Lemmon. Right, the Aspen fire burned about 85,000 acres over the course of about a month. Right, this is 130 square miles. There were 340 homes that were destroyed by this. The suppression cost for that one fire, right, was $17 million for that month worth of fire suppression work. I was actually working for the University of Arizona Archaeological Field School while the Aspen fire was burning, working with, Dr. Barbara Mills. And it was the summer before that was my life-changing event. Right? I was actually living in Hawaii at the time. I know, don't feel too sorry for me. I had come to Arizona. My passion for archaeology had been inspired, but also I fell in love. And my wife, she was pursuing graduate work at the University of Hawaii. And so I moved out to Hawaii, unsure about what I was going to do, or where my intellectual fires, pun intended, would be lit. Was working on an NSF project when I was getting emails from the U of A about evacuations, about my friends and my mentors from the field school who were working in a part of Arizona that has such a rich archaeological history that the U of A and U of A related archaeologists have been working there for almost a century at this point. And here they were being evacuated in the face of what became at the time the largest fire in Arizona's recorded history, the Rodeo Chedisky fire, right? So this was almost exactly a year before, just for scale, 460,000 acres. So roughly 720 square miles, one fire. Over the same window of time, about 3 weeks, 400 homes destroyed, one really influential photo tower destroyed. From Emil Howery days, we can get into that. There's some great artifacts of the history of archaeology that were impacted by this. But the suppression costs in 2003 for that were about $43 million for that one fire. But it struck me while I was in Hawaii that there was some dissonance here, right? We'd had almost 100 years of really great archaeological work in this area in these beautiful pine forests. We were learning an awful lot about how people lived in those environments. But I wasn't sure if we had any idea about how they lived with fire in these flammable environments, these places that we were really struggling with today to come to grips with what living in those kind of environments was like. And I thought, oh gosh, I've got to come back to Arizona. I've got to come back to work for Barbara. And I want to figure this out. I think it's important that we figure this out, because how could people have lived there for centuries, many, many centuries and longer without running the same problems? We're there for, you know, a century and a few decades at population levels even close to those. And all of a sudden we're having homes destroyed and forests converted into completely different environments. So that has kind of set me on my path to try to figure out, okay, well, how did people live in these environments, right? And fundamentally, not just from the standpoint of intellectual curiosity, there's certainly that, but what can we learn from how they did this to make for better management of these forests today? How can we learn from those centuries of experience and wisdom to make better choices in those same environments today? And so I want to kind of talk you through bits of how we know what fires were like in the first place, how I've gone about with many people. Archaeology used to be like golf and was really kind of a solo sport. Now it's very much a team sport. I'm an international soccer guy, so think of it more like 11-on-11 international football. But you can't work alone, and I work with great people, and I've continued working with T.J. Ferguson, of those who are in the audience here, as well as folks at the Tree Ring Lab, and archaeologists and fire scientists kind of across the U.S. and actually across the globe. And so this is a very personal story for me, but this is one that is, I'm just a figurehead in this case. This is definitely a team effort. So one question that we always wrestle with, of course, and have wrestled with for a couple hundred years at least, in terms of fire in the West, is this something that is natural, right? It should be in these forests, or is it something that was put there by the Indians, right? That fire was a product of Indian management, and for good or for ill, depending on your ideological persuasion and how you interpret that. Is it human or is it natural? And so for a few decades in the late 20th century, we were really kind of stuck in that rut of, well, is fire natural? Is it human? And sure enough, guess what? It's both, right? And in fact, just to give you the biggest of big pictures, right, fire, landscape fire, wildfire as we might think of it, has been on the planet for at least 400 million years, right? It's a powerful geologic and evolutionary force, right? 400 million years, so definitely natural. But people have been using, well, humans and human ancestors have been using fire for at least a million years. And so with people comes a pretty sophisticated understanding of combustion and manipulation of fuels, both for technological purposes and in ecological settings. And so the better kind of questions we can ask are not, is this human or is it natural, but are more akin to, how do human activities influence the way that landscapes burn, right? And especially in the context of real serious awareness of contemporary climate challenges, how do people influence the vulnerability of forests to certain types of climate dynamics or directional climate change? In ways that might produce behaviors that we don't want, whether that's threatening property or threatening cultural landscapes or places of aesthetic and spiritual value. And so these are a very different kind of question, and one that requires that we look at multiple dimensions. So there's a lot that I'll talk about that's not distinctively archaeology. Either. The work that I do, I describe as applied historical ecology. That is, using ecological histories to inform contemporary management. Now, archaeology doesn't always have a role to play in that, or hasn't anyway. From my vantage point, it should. And the reason that I think it should is we can quibble about the relative importance of human activities in a particular ecosystem at a particular time in the past. I don't think we can quibble about the scale of the human footprint on the globe today. And so there's no question that contemporary environmental challenges are human environmental challenges. And so archaeologists, by way of our training and our interest and our expertise in exploring those human environment relationships, to be involved in this, and in fact, I would argue to lead in this, and so that's why I'm in the position that I am relative to the projects that I'm involved with, even if kind of from an observational standpoint, it might seem like, well, there's very little archaeology that's going on in this project. At its core, the ideas are, in my view, archaeological ones. Certainly, the way that I was trained here at the U of A to think about what archaeology is in the biggest setting. I also work primarily in the Southwest in ponderosa pine forests. Right? Everybody know what ponderosa pine forests are? Right? Very distinctive type of tall pine. When they're mature, nice yellow bark. When they're healthy and you're out there in the summertime, to me they smell like vanilla. Right? And you go out in a ponderosa pine forest, and just nothing smells better than being out in this, you know, vanilla yellow belly, as the foresters used to call the old growth ponderosa yellow belly forest. For a few reasons. One, they have a really long human history. Right? Many of the sites that Barbara Mills, and before her, Jeff Reed, and Bill Longacre, and Ray Thompson, and Emil Howey had worked in were ponderosa pine forests in east central Arizona along the Mogollon Rim. and the Point of Pines area. But also, this is one of the forest types whose history of fire, right, the ecology of fire, we know better than almost any place else in the world. And we know that because of the history of fire recorded in tree rings. And of course, tree rings are another specialty of this place, a science that was invented here at the University of Arizona. And so I'm going to point out a few things on this cross-section of a conifer. This actually comes from California, but it illustrates many of the points that I want to make. And Doug's got a couple of sections to pass around. You can take a look at the wood. Right, we can use the story of time, ecology, and environment that are coded in the rings of the trees, of these ponderosa pine trees, to understand the history of that tree. So one thing that's really important is that in these types of forests, fire typically doesn't kill mature trees. They've got a number of adaptations that evolved a little more than a million years ago here in North America to a very specific type of fire. Right? They have really thick bark. They drop their lower branches. That's called self-pruning. I wish trees in my yard self-pruned. They rotate their needles relatively quickly, so they actually create their own fuel bed to be able to burn. And so what happens is that young trees will get killed in these fires, but the mature trees survive. And in certain circumstances where there may be a down log or on the upslope side of a tree on a hill slope, the fire eddies to get just hot enough to kill the part of the tissue. Right along the edge here is what we call cambium. That's basically how the tree grows. And if it's killed in just one spot, basically the tree tries to heal itself. It tries to grow over and it creates this curl. And that curl is what we call a fire scar, right? And so all this dark color is the other kind of protection of the tree. So it's trying to grow over. It's also protecting itself from insects by getting really resinous and pitchy. But that means that each one of these fire events, we can date to the year, and in some cases, actually, to the part of the growing season in which the fire happened. And so this is a really nice section where we've got fires once to twice every decade until you get to the 20th century, basically. And then fires go away, and you get this classic 20th century curl. Some people call this the Smoky Bear curl. I actually kind of like to call it the Dolly the Sheep curl, because Smoky only happens actually about halfway through this. The real trigger for fire suppression in the Southwest is what happens? Sheep happens. Sometimes that joke works, and sometimes it goes like that. Yeah. In the late 19th century, right, New Mexico and Arizona were the envy of Wales. There were so many sheep and cattle that they basically outcompeted fire for the fuels. And that created kind of cascading feedbacks, which drove accumulating coarser fuels on the ground. It removed those fires that happened so frequently that thinned out the young trees and allow big cohorts of young trees to create those dog hair thickets, right? Those stands of really densely packed, small diameter trees that foresters call dog hair. Foresters have such colorful language, they're really great. Right? They're thick as dog hair. That changed the way those forests burn, right? Those forests, the Aspen fire, the Rodeo Chediscai fire, didn't burn like those nice surface fires that burn just around the foot of the trees. They burned up in the crown of the trees. We call it a crown fire. And those kill ponderosa pines. And if you go up to Pinedale today, it's not a ponderosa pine forest anymore, very sadly. It's different, and it's probably not going to be a pine forest for a long time, even sadder still. And so it makes you wonder, okay, all right, so if these types of systems, right, these forest systems that rely on very, very frequent but very specific types of fire, right, have the nature of the fuels and the way that fires change fundamentally alter them, right? In some cases, removing them completely. What did people do? How did people live through this, right? if you look at a network of these tree ring sites across the Southwest, you see this the same story over the last few hundred years. Right? The seasonality is such that these happen. Anybody want to venture a guess? June? I hear June? Huh? Yeah, so basically once or twice a decade, typically, and in the terms of the part of year, they happen in June, mostly, right? When things are warm, dry, haven't had rain in a while, just before the monsoon kicks off, you might have dry lightning storms, right? There are natural mechanisms for creating this type of fire pattern. You don't have to have people necessarily to create that kind of fire pattern. But we know that people are evolved. We wouldn't have Dollar the Sheep if it weren't for people in the Smoky Bear Curl. So what kind of things did people do, right, to live through this period of time, prevent these sorts of periods of time? Or did we have periods like this, right? And if so, what kind of things led to those conditions? Are there climatological reasons why these kind of conditions could have happened? Maybe breakdowns in the patterns that create this. Right? So one of the things that you can do with tree rings, other than dating archaeological sites and dating fire scars, and so as these go around, you'll see the pitch and look for the little curls as the tree's trying to grow over and heal itself, is you can actually reconstruct climate. Whatever the single most limiting climate variable is for those trees, and in the Southwest, this is by and large moisture, precipitation. And so you probably wouldn't want to reconstruct precipitation from a tree that has had so many other things going on in its life, like fires. But if you can find trees, and there are plenty of trees that don't record fire scars, they don't have this, the wide and narrow rings are a product of how much moisture that tree had to use to grow. And so you can actually use the width of the rings to reconstruct precipitation or use drought indices, stretching back actually more than 2,000 years. And so one thing you can actually see in the timing of these, right, the timing of when fires happen, is that there's a strong climate pattern in this. And globally, we have a good sense of this now. Climate is a really strong kind of organizing agent for fires. Even 97, anybody here alive in 97? Oh, okay. Have to ask. I teach millennials now. 1997 was the last kind of mega El Nino, and the smoke emissions from deforestation fires and peat fires in Indonesia were so bad that year. Right? They crossed international boundaries, created real controversy in the South Pacific kind of geopolitical discourse. And the reason that there was so much burning in that winter 97-98 is partly because, right, El Nino was really strong. It was really, really dry there. But all those fires were started by people. these were fires that wouldn't have been there without people. And so just because there's a really strong organizing climate dimension to both the production of fuels and the preparation of fuels to be able to burn doesn't mean that the human part of the story is insignificant, right? If you were to look at that Indonesian fire record, you might think, well, climate is the strong driver. People really didn't matter. It's all being driven by climate, and you just have a pretty nonsensical story there. And so the same thing could be true here, right? Just because we've got this really great climate pattern between basically, now I can go marker style. The years of moisture that are necessary to create the fuels that carry the fire, and a year in which conditions are right for fires to happen, it might seem contradictory, but El Nino actually is a really important part of the story. So if you imagine with me that you had a calendar and your calendar, like the tree rings, were based on the years, and every year you had a fire, that was a special calendar marker. And you were to look back over your entire history using those fire years as your reference points. More often than not, what you would see, and statistically there's a way of doing this, is that during a fire year, so say fire year is year T, be a good statistician here, year T, the fire year, these are by and large, dry years, right? You have dry and wet. Please pardon the handwriting. But that's not the entire story. In order to have fires recorded as fire scars that spread across landscapes in these types of settings, because these are dry forests, you need to have conditions that produce a lot of grass, a lot of needles that can carry a fire. And so in the couple of years before, T minus one, T minus two, the couple of years before a fire, if you were to look back at all these counters organized by that fire year, you would see this pattern really regularly. There are two, maybe three wet years, unusually wet years even, the years before a fire, and that's as important as the dry fire year. And over the last few centuries, this pattern, which comes with the kind of frequency of normal El Nino, La Nina switching, where El Ninos are good at producing lots of fuel, so in a couple of years from now, we're going to have a lot of fuels ready to carry fire, even if this year may not be quite so bad. And then when that dry year happens, shortly thereafter, then you've got lots of fires. And across the Southwest, across hundreds, actually a couple thousand tree ring samples from ponderosa pine, you see this replicated in the last couple hundred years. There's a synchrony to it that's related to this wet, wet, dry, year-to-year moisture switching. Working with the recently retired director of the tree ring lab, Tom Swetnam, we took advantage of this and said, you know, this is really robust. Several studies have produced this over and over and over again. I wonder if we can take those really great long records of precipitation from tree rings and model out the frequency of this pattern to see if maybe there are periods of time in the past, maybe periods of time when native peoples were living out in those environments, when this pattern fell apart, right? Where you don't see this happen very often, where you might have Dolly or Smokey Bear acting through some sort of climate vehicle that reduces the patterns that create these decadal surface fires. And so we did that. We created a long-term model to do that. And one part of the story is reassuring. Mostly over the last couple thousand years, you see this happen as frequently as you did over the last few hundred years, right? So these forests probably had, you know, one to two fires every decade over the last 1,500 years. But there are a couple periods of time when that pattern did break down, where you might have had dog hair thickets form in at least some places. And it turns out that one of those, the most prolonged one of those periods of time, is actually a really interesting archaeological period of time, and really interesting in eastern Arizona in particular. In the mid-1300s through the 1400s, this pattern breaks down. There's less year-to-year variance, and as a result, the conditions aren't very good for surface fires. It's also a period of time when people are moving around the Southwest. You've probably heard this in many other talks, right? The 1300s are a really dynamic period of time in the Southwest. And in eastern Arizona, along the Mogollon Rim, I'll probably give you, for those of you who may not know, a little geography for this. Inspired by Steve Nash's really great map of Colorado, New Mexico, Arizona. I'm going to go further and actually make Arizona kind of look like Arizona. And New Mexico look kind of like New Mexico. Ponderosa pine forests, the biggest continuous stand is kind of along the really rugged mountainous transition zone between the Sonoran Desert down here and the Colorado Plateau. This is the biggest and most continuous stand of ponderosa pine in the world, actually. Well, it was until the radio Chev Scott put a big hole through it. And so the area where I worked in Barbara and Jeff Reed and Emil Howie's footsteps is here. And during that period of time, from the early 1300s into about 1400, you see people moving in, people moving out, new communities forming and collapsing within a generation. and some persisting. And so as a big part of my dissertation, I wanted to use that dynamism in the human story, mapped on to that tree-ring reconstruction of climate influencing fire, to see whether or not people influenced how fires happened in a way that had a legacy, had a legacy sustaining those types of fires in the face of climate processes that might allow for some crown fires. Nothing like Radochetiskaya, mind you, but for smaller scale patches of hot fires. And so what I did was basically use parts of the landscape that were unoccupied. There's nobody home. Parts of the landscape that were occupied but for just a part of that window of time, and parts of that landscape that were occupied through its entirety. And in this case, not using tree rings, but using geologic indicators of fire, plant communities, and erosion from fires across these types of settings to try to see, okay, if people were influencing these in ways that had positive outcomes, maybe reducing the vulnerability to these types of climate events, we shouldn't see any evidence for forest loss or changes in fire here. We might hear, we might hear. And so what I did with some fellow graduate students from the University of Arizona was go to little drainages and cut trenches into the faces of these little valleys that were accumulating soil that was running off, collecting little pieces of charcoal and pollen from the plants that were growing there, to reconstruct fire and the forest composition over that period of time, basically over the last 1,000 years. And what we found was that there's more fire when people are living there, but it's in the context of the same kind of forest that you find elsewhere. The only difference is that you've got, you guys may be surprised to find this, maize. So there's fire and they were growing corn and other crops, certainly. And so the fire is not necessarily converting the forest. There are other things that we suspect that most likely what they're doing is adding to whatever surface fires are happening, maybe to recycle nutrients for agriculture, or maybe a little more tenuously creating a nice blackened surface in the spring to buffer late frosts by having a black surface to absorb sunlight and heat. But in these places, right, where people are either there for a very short period of time or never setting up homes in these parts of the landscape, we do have evidence during those tree ring climate windows of the potential for crown fires. We have evidence for crown fires. Some of them, these here, for example, actually have their entire basin burned out. There are no trees at all for several centuries. The forest does come back, which is one of the exciting and reassuring bits. But as you get 10, 15, 20 miles away from where people are living, their impact is different, right? People lived at a scale in this landscape that's kind of hard for us to think about, even though we live, of course, at a very large scale, and most of you probably live in foothills and drove in. But the people certainly were using further parts of the landscape, but probably in a very different way than the really intensively occupied parts. And so the lesson that I took from this is that having people out on a landscape that is adapted to a certain type of fire may be invisible in certain contexts, may be impossible to distinguish from the lightning-driven spreading surface fire context. But in other times, right, in other climate scenarios, it might be really, really important to have lots of extra ignitions out on the landscape when the fuels might be fragmented, because the fire on the surface is so key for driving the dynamics in the canopy of the forest and creating the conditions that allow for big spreading crown fires that threaten homes, that destroy watersheds, and result in the loss of the forest. And so this is a scenario where we think people are doing a lot of ecological good, even if they're virtually invisible at certain analytical scales. And so I've kind of moved on to working in New Mexico now, exploring this story a bit further. And I'm not going to talk about that too much because I don't think I've got the time to do it. We know that many of these human fire relationships are scale dependent. And the number of people living here in Arizona, over I think about 160 square miles, or at about a population density of no more than 1 to 2 people per square mile, right? Not a particularly high density, not particularly low density, in truth, but it's a part of a global spectrum where we might expect people to be able to add more fire to the landscape. In places as diverse as California, as historic Western Missouri, as modern sub-Saharan Africa, we see what we call a humpy distribution of population and fire. Quite literally, it looks something like this. That this is more fire. This is more people. That as you increase the number of people, up to a point, you can add more fire. Beyond that, you actually have a change in the nature of human impacts. That even if they're adding ignitions, as is the case in sub-Saharan Africa for sure, the landscape becomes so fragmented that fires aren't connected, the fuels aren't connected. And so even if the number of fires increases, the amount of area burned decreases. And so we've moved on to work in New Mexico now, where over a smaller area, we have a population density for several centuries of about 40 to 45 people per square mile, right? Much larger, an order of magnitude more people. And we have a different story, but I won't drag on about that, and I'll open it up to questions. But before I wrap up, the one thing I want to say is that I could not have done this without the century of basic archaeological research that was done. I didn't have to do any new archaeology to do this research because it had been done. And so the big concerns about funding applied versus very basic research and how NSF should spend its money. An awful lot of applied work simply can't happen without a long record of basic science to build upon. And so all of the applied work that I do certainly is situated on the shoulders of giants, some of whom are present with us, without whom we couldn't actually even begin to ask these questions. It would take too long. It would take a century to do this kind of work. And so thank you for your patience, and happy to answer any questions.
My first question. And in the back.
So the presence of people increases the frequency of fire. Do you have some sense how that breaks down between people adding fuel and people adding ignition?
That's a great question. I would say in the Eastern Arizona study, and go back to the map. Not really able to parse that particularly well. The records that I have, which are basically abundances of charcoal in these flood deposits, are they're richer in charcoal, and so by a pretty coarse proxy, there's more biomass being consumed or incompletely consumed on the landscape to wash in than in analogous basins where people aren't there. So it seems like there's more biomass being burned, although in truth, I might actually step back from there being more frequent fires. In that more frequent fires tend to consume that fuel and tend to therefore have a lower fuel load, so when these post-fire deposits accumulate, there's actually less charcoal. Because the fuels are finer and there's less to burn. So there's clearly a human signal, and this is for those of you who know the area just south of Sholo, the Forestdale Valley where Admiral Howery ran a field school many, many decades ago. In that area, during the pre-contact occupation, big thick charcoal deposits associated with those ancestral Pueblo occupations. But it's really variable, and I suspect actually it's a kind of a fundamentally different kind of fire, although it's still happening in the same kind of context. Maybe a little coarser, maybe a little more needle dominated than grass dominated, so less ponderous a savanna maybe. But hard to say. Haven't looked at the taxonomy of the charcoal to work out whether it's really changing biomass type, for example. In New Mexico, we think there's something quite a bit different, right? The global picture would suggest that the impacts on fuel amounts and continuity would be much greater, right? 40 plus people per square mile, it's a lot of people. They're living at in this case, about 7,000 feet. They've got to heat and light their homes. Even without domesticated animals, the potential to have a real impact on fuel amounts and continuity would be really great. And there is a really significant part of that story that is related to that there. Even as there's still a fire story. You get away from the places where people live, there's lots and lots of fires every year, but they're really patchy, they're tiny. They're what we call singletons. They're only recorded on one tree, they're not spreading. And that's analogous to the way a lot of people globally, a lot of indigenous people globally use fire in really small patches, creating real heterogeneity and diversity.
Another question? Okay.
When you look at the charcoal and the other things in the soil, how accurate can you be time-wise? Mm-hmm. Are you down to 100 years? Or are you like 400 years? Because it kind of relates to which group of indigenous people. Apparently, the Apaches didn't move into Arizona until the 1600s. Some say the 15, some say the 16. They have a different style because they actually use fire as a war tool. They used to burn villages out, and they didn't go right up to the village. They would burn, 1,000 acres before they hit the village. How accurate is your soil analysis? Thank you.
No, that's a spectacular question. For as wonderful and precise as tree ring dating is, and I have a really good, some of my good friends are radiocarbon people. Radiocarbon dating ain't that, right? But in certain contexts, it's not that bad. So what I did from these stratified soil settings was pull out things that had a very short growing life. So the pine needles themselves. So the pines grow those, and they are on the tree for no more than 5 to 7 years or so, and they're dropped. And if fires are happening often enough, then those are burned and redeposited relatively quickly. So there's a very, very short, maybe a decade lag between the death age, what's the potential radiocarbon age, and the deposit that you may be dating. And so that's good. That's a nice tight relationship. The uncertainty of the measurement of radiocarbon obviously puts a slightly larger bracket on this. But when you have a relatively rapidly accumulating floodplain, so you've got floods in these little, these are really ephemeral drainages. They don't hold water year round, but they flood every year when they're building up. And so you've got a pretty good degree of confidence that this layer was there before this layer was there was before this layer. And you can actually use that information statistically when evaluating the radiocarbon dates. And so geologists and archaeologists use a method called Bayesian radiocarbon calibration, which uses Bayesian statistics to construct those age ranges using the other information. So it evaluates the likelihood that this had to be before this and constrains the ages a bit. And so when you do that, you can get 50 to 100 year kind of intervals for some of these deposits. So in terms of parsing out, say, the Apache versus the ancestral Pueblo, especially since in this area it looks like there's likely at least a couple century hiatus between the two, it's relatively easy to do. In terms of, say, using the record, and there's some signs of Apache burning that are very different, by the way, in those soils. Saying exactly when Apache showed up on the basis of these radiocarbon dates, I would not want to touch that because of the uncertainty involved. The short of it is, very grossly speaking, it corroborates the archaeology. It might be as early as the very, very end of the 16th century, late 1500s, or the early 1600s. Neither of those would be too surprising archaeologically, although the early one would be a little bit early. But within the uncertainty, I couldn't say where exactly that would fit. It would even be okay if I said it was 1650, and that would be within the range of the radiocarbon dates that I have. But it's enough to parse those out. And yeah, sure enough, the Apache use is different, very different. It's a setting where there's not nearly as much coarse charcoal coming in these systems, but there is evidence for altered plant communities, including a lot of economically important plants that aren't domesticates. Lots of those weeds, those disturbance plants that produce greens and seeds that were really important to Apaches, those show up in large numbers during the Apache period in the places where the Apaches were living and using. I should say too, there's one anecdote from early 20th century ethnography that I like to share in these kind of settings from a very famous cultural anthropologist, Leslie White, who worked around the Southwest. And almost in kind of an offhanded comment in his reporting on the ethnography at Acoma Pueblo, he describes a particular a kachina ceremony in which young men in the guise or as earthly representations of certain kachina spirits go out in carnal directions up to 20 kilometers away from the Pueblo. And set fires at midnight, and set fires in the landscape all the way back to the Pueblo, and where they completed with a community dance, as you might be able to imagine. This is something that the ecological significance didn't hit Leslie White, which is only surprising because he was so ecologically cognizant in the rest of his work. Although he did acknowledge about a decade later the origin story for that particular kachina ceremony, which contextualized it a bit. The Corn Clan was responsible for this. The leaders of the Corn Clan would get together every year in late June or early July, the seasonality should sound familiar, to decide whether or not this was a year to do this. They did it, you know, every 5 to 10 years. Early July, and these were places pretty far removed from the Pueblo. This was not something that had a very clear functional importance, but the ecological knowledge that was embedded in the seasonality, the context, the frequency of these fires was reflected in the origin story, right? They came across these kachinas doing this on the landscape in the legendary past, and it's almost as if Leslie White or the kachina spirit or both already knew about Smokey Bear because the kachina says, no, wait, I'm not doing this to destroy the planet. I'm doing this to heat up Mother Earth and make her more productive. And unlike so many of us viewers of Bambi so many years ago, the Corn Clan said, no, we get it. We want you to come back to Acoma and lead the Corn Clan and do this. And they did for a period of time before they went back to their mountain homes. And then the Corn Clan was responsible for maintaining this. And it gets back to that ambiguity, right? Fundamentally, this is indistinguishable from what we know from fire scars in terms of the time of year this happened, the frequency this happened, the context in which this happened. But this was really foundationally embedded in cultural knowledge. And this probably didn't matter so much to the people who were trying to understand their relationship, whether it was started by lightning, whether it was started by people. These were all managements, at least in the appropriate managements, that are in the spirit of the natural world as it should be. And I think we can learn a lot from that, both that ethos and the particulars of these stories.
I was wondering what contributes to the Crown Fire if you don't have the mat below, yeah, and it's being cleared out. Is it the wind? What makes the fire go to the crown instead of burning?
That's an excellent question. From kind of a mechanistic standpoint, in the ponderosa pine forest that Euro-Americans encountered 120 years ago when they brought Dolly the sheep out, these were very open, widely spaced trees of different ages, right? High what the foresters would call the base of the canopy, the crown base height. And the fuels on the ground were mostly grasses and down needles. So typically the flame lengths were only about like this. So you couldn't get that in normal weather conditions anyway, you couldn't, right? There weren't ladder fuels, as they say. There's nothing to carry the fire up. There are some indications that in really small patches, when the topography is right, when the position of the jet stream is just right, you can have such kind of sheer wind strength that you can actually pull up flames into at least some young conifers that might run for a stretch driven by just by wind. So it's what fire people would call an independent or running crown fire, where there's actually not even fire on the surface, it's just in the crown. Those tend to be really small. The way that they happen now is because those dog hair thickets create a ladder. Right? So then a fire that starts down here has lots of fuel immediately around it, all those other stressed out young trees. They're like, you know, teenagers. They're all stressed out and tweaking and not sure what to do, not enough water. But then, you know, they're also angry at the parents and they're reaching up and they're taking fire into the crown. And then it has a chance to run wild.
We have another question over here.
As applied research, it seems like your findings have some policy implications, and will you talk about those for a few minutes?
Sure. Certainly from the Arizona story, there are discussions in the forest management world, and there are people who are more expert at this than me here in the back. About the role of what they call wildland fire use, basically letting fires that were started naturally or under natural enough conditions to just be allowed to burn, regardless of what the forest conditions are like, which is the relative importance of getting out there and thinning the forest first to create a structure where they're not going to get into the crown, because if you set a fire in a lot of these forests, it's not going to have good consequences because the structure of the fuels is going to promote crown fires, not the kind of fires we want. And there's some people who want that, what we call thinning or fuels treatment, but would prefer to have lightning do the rest of the work. And they think that, right, the investment, because it is an investment, it's costly to do this, although remember, $1.5 billion a year in fire suppression in the U.S. Is also a lot of money. That then we can just let nature take its course. That might work. Sometimes it might work a lot of the time. My suspicion, though, from the Arizona story in particular, is that especially now with as fragmented as we've made the forest with Forest Service roads intended to help fight fires, with ex-urban communities peppered throughout there and their amenities and trails and infrastructure, that lightning started fires, even if the fuels were right, actually can't spread the way that they would without threatening infrastructure, and that we need to have a denser network of ignitions, that active human prescribed fire probably needs to be a really important part of the equation. And that we can't expect to thin it and then let lightning take care of it, that under all climate conditions, it doesn't look like that works, right? Certainly from the historical record. And under our current cultural landscape, I suspect it probably wouldn't work everywhere, too. I can imagine people in a pine top lakeside where they're still living with pine trees being told, no, just let that fire just kind of burn through your neighborhood. And probably not.
Any other questions? Over here.
Is there any prehistoric record of reignition, like what is a very common practice these days, where a lightning-caused fire will start, and it goes out because it's monsoon season, so it goes out. But then the Forest Service comes racing back in and reignites. Is there any prehistoric record that the native peoples used reignition throughout an area?
So that's a good question. From the kind of historical records that we have, so tree rings and sediments, right, sediments are the most coarsely resolved, so that's all we get from those is kind of big picture. From the tree rings, right, we can actually get at the seasonality of the fires, and we can say that the seasonality is not uniform. Right, there's definitely a modality to it. By and large, they happen in that dry, by late May to June time period. But there's some that happen late, right, that are probably August, September. And some that happen when the tree's not growing at all, and we don't know, is that potentially even October, November, or is that, say, March? We usually use contextual information, so if there are other trees that also record a fire, say, in the very beginning of its growth, and we say, oh, okay, well, this is probably at the real early fire that happened when this tree wasn't growing, but its neighbor was. Or if it happens and it's in the, we call the late wood, the dark, and the wood that's going around, the dark bit is what we call the late wood. If it's in the late wood of one of its neighbors, then we say, okay, that's a late season fire of that year. But whether or not those are restarted from fires that had gone out are difficult to know. Certainly there's evidence from some of the other folks in the tree ring lab looking at networks of fire scars across the Southwest of very likely kind of mountain range scale fires that are spreading in a discontinuous pattern, but probably weaving from very early in one place to very, very late in other parts of those mountain ranges. And it's hard to imagine just how disconnected disconnected from a fuel standpoint is today, how hyper-connected with roads, that in the past, there would have been opportunities for an ignition to carry across, say, the entire Benson-San Pedro area. There actually are historic newspapers that describe grassland fires sweeping from one side of the San Pedro all the way to the other over huge areas, and actually over the course of many months making their way doing that. It really is kind of hard to imagine. I mean, these big epic fires, we're talking about Rodeo Chediscai and Aspen, 3 to 4 weeks. But and in other parts of the world, like in Siberia, one of the samples that passed around was a really nice one from Siberia, has a similar kind of fire regime. Yeah, those things can burn for months and months and months.
Okay, we have a question over here.
You don't, I assume, have the data that allows you to get to the down to the nitty-gritty of knowing how big an area from a, say, 10-room pueblo or 100-room pueblo or 1,000-room pueblo, how many acres that those groups would be, would be impacting?
Oh, boy, that's a great question. I wish I had an answer for that. It's something that in the New Mexico study area we're really trying to explore, especially because the nature of those dynamics are even more complicated because there's so many people. The impacts on wood use are myriad and not entirely well known. TJ's been doing really great ethnographic work trying to understand fuel and other wood preferences for a variety of activities. And now we're trying to scale that back to, okay, what would the consequences of that have been on the landscape, especially if they're living in ponderosa pine, but their preferred wood uses are in a different forest type, and how that would have played out and had feedbacks and legacy effects and on wildlife, including deer populations and jackrabbits and other important animal foods. I don't have a good answer. I say that I'm with you, and I want to know. The scale of the impact in New Mexico is probably really large because there are 6,500-7,000 people just in our area, and then there are communities living around this mountain range. If you want to find this mountain range, you can go to Google Earth and look for the Millennium Falcon, more or less, is kind of what it looks like from the air. This green Millennium Falcon, that's the pine forest around the Jemez Mountains. And we've got a network of tree ring work all through those mountains. And during the time when populations were really high, there were lots and lots of small fires. And that's including really far afield from where people are living. That's probably hunting, medicinal plant work, other pilgrimages, much more complicated and far-flung land use than, you know, the nitty-gritty of, you know, domestic maintenance and house building and cooking and agricultural fields. And that scale, that scalar part of the impact is one that needs to be taken into consideration when working this out, that it's not a uniform footprint on the land.
I think we have a question here.
I was just wondering, in your study, did you correct for the density of the forest? It seems like there would be more people, if there'd be more people, or people would tend to be in places where there are more trees. Or is that true or not?
Oh, that's a really, really good question. In terms of the historic forests, the descriptions for the density of ponderosa pine forests are pretty uniformly low density. In fact, some observers kind of border on describing them as almost parklands or savannas. Just 5, 10, 15 trees per hectare, right? Really open. Then, and a lot of sunlight, a lot of grass. We assume that that's probably the case in the past. Don't really know. We kind of project that backwards. In the New Mexico area, probably because the ancestors of the modern Pueblo of Jemez, so these are Jemez ancestors, they lived up in these pine forests into the 1600s. And so we actually were able to use tree ring work to build both fire and forest history from around these pueblos. And yeah, in the immediate vicinity of these pueblos, there are few, if any, trees, actually. Probably for a few reasons. And there's definitely a concern among modern people that their ancestors were likely cognizant of the fire threats and the danger of having a lot of fuels close to their homes, but also the utility, frankly, of especially of young trees is easy to harvest with stone axes and hand tools, literally your hands, to throw in the fireplace, as well as literally thousands of feet trampling around on the ground every day. They weren't really hospitable places for trees to grow once people had kind of cleared out and built their village. And it's not actually for a decade or two after people left those villages that we see tree growth again on the villages. And then we see it happen kind of all at once in the 1630s, 1640s, 1650s. And if anybody's interested, we have a paper in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science that's open access. Everybody can see this. Where we look at several of these sites, and it's only basically when the population collapses from Spanish diseases and raiding and other problems of the contact period that forests regrow basically on these villages, and it's 1630s, 1640s, 1650s, and before that there are very few if any trees. At most of these sites, actually, they're as far as we can document, no living trees on them within a few hundred meters.
So just a couple of comments. First of all, the work that Chris is referring to that involves T.J. Ferguson, Tom Swetnam, and Chris, that is in the Jemez area, will actually be a topic of an Archaeology Southwest magazine about a year from now. So what he hasn't told you is in the reserve there and is coming out relatively soon. And just a kind of a personal question. You commented on how the smell of vanilla in the ponderosa pine setting. So when you walk up to a tree to collect your data, are you looking for certain aspects of a tree? Can you read something about the fire history on the exterior of a tree, or do you get surprised by what's on the interior of your samples?
That's a great question. So on living trees in ponderosa pine forests, very oftentimes you can see the fire scars. They look very different than this cross section. They have kind of a V-shaped face to them, where it's broader at the base and it kind of tapers to a point. Foresters have another colorful name for that that I won't share with you. And so those you can see on the living trees, but those also tend to be relatively young. And so for the work in New Mexico, where we're really trying to stretch the tree ring record as far back as we can, we're looking at really gnarly old pieces on the ground that have survived probably because they're really pitchy. And yeah, there you actually don't really know exactly what you're going to see until you cross-section it, because they might be really weathered and twisted fragments. You might be able to see remnants of a fire scar. So one of the great quirks of evolutionary fate is that this resin in the wood is there to protect it from insects, boring insects. That's the other kind of defense that the tree has. But it also protects it from microbial decay after the tree's downed and dead. So it's the fire scar trees that sit around on the landscape the longest. And even as the rest of the wood rots away, this really pitchy resinous bit will stay there. And so in the Bahamas, we have fire scar trees, especially on rocky protected areas where they've also been protected by fire from more recent fires that go back into the 1100s. Those are great surprises. And those things, actually, sometimes they even look like rocks. They've got lichen growing on them. Really, really cool.
Okay, any other questions? All right, well, Chris, thank you very much. Fantastic talk.
Thank you.